All right, well, good morning, everybody. If I could go ahead and have everyone find and take a seat, we're going to go ahead and get started with our service this morning. I want to welcome you to worship with us this morning. If you are a guest with us, we want you to know that we are so thankful that you are here with us. If you would, please look in the pew back in front of you. You'll find a little card that says Connect Card. And if you would fill that out, that helps us to have a record of your visit. And when we pass around the offering at the end of the service, if you would drop that in the offering basket, that helps us to know you are here. We would like to reach out to you and make ourselves available to answer any questions that you may have about Glen Haven. This morning, I have a handful of anniversaries to recognize. And so if when I call your name, if you would, please stand up. And we'll hold our applause till the end because we have several this morning. So let's start off with Pastor Matt and Miss Emily Puckett celebrating 8 years of marriage. Denny and Ashley Lay celebrating 10 years of marriage. We have Miss Angel and David Goodon celebrating 27 years of marriage. Kim and Andrea Cleveland celebrating 29 years of marriage. Mr. Jim and Miss Kitty Cox celebrating 49 years of marriage. And Neil and Miss Helen Riker celebrating 64 years of marriage. Let's give it up for all of these couples. If I didn't introduce myself, my name is Jarrett. I have the privilege of serving as one of the pastors here on staff at Glen Haven. And it has been a very difficult week for me and for my family. And if it were not for the body of Christ here at Glen Haven, I don't know what we would do. I don't know where we would be without you guys. And so my three-year-old nephew, Zaid, passed away last week. We got to celebrate his life yesterday in his homegoing service. And that's exactly what we did. We celebrated the 3 years that God gave to Zaid, and we also comforted ourselves with the hope that we have in the resurrection, that he has gone home and that one day we will see him again when his body is raised and our bodies are raised alongside of him. But you guys were amazing in caring for my family, for my in-laws, Tyler and Michelle, for our extended family. You did so much for us, and you came around us. You are the hands and feet of Jesus, and I know so many of you were praying that God would sustain us and strengthen our faith during this time, and I firmly believe that the body of Christ, that you guys were the answer to your own prayers, that God used you to strengthen us and to sustain us, and so thank you for doing that. Yesterday, we closed Zaid's service in a song of praise and thanksgiving to God. Because we know that he is God and that he is not cold, he is not distant, but he loved us so much that he chose to come and enter our suffering, to die a sacrificial death and rise from the grave so that he may bring us out of this world. Jesus said, in this world, we are going to have difficulties. We're going to have trials. We're going to have tribulations, but that we can take heart because he has overcome the world. And so we ended yesterday's service by praising God, and that's exactly how we're going to begin our service today, by singing praise and worship to God. So I'm going to invite you to stand with me. I'm going to open our service in prayer, and we're going to sing an upbeat song of praise and worship to our God. Amen? Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the opportunity we have to come into your house this morning with your people that you have saved by the blood of your Son. And we come to bring you praise and worship this morning. We pray that you would fill us right now with your Holy Spirit, that we may worship you in spirit and in truth. We pray that you would open our hearts and our ears to hear your word, that we may take it to heart, that we may obey it, that we may do the work that you have for us to do, and so build your Son's kingdom and bring him glory. God, would you come and inhabit the praises of your people right now? And would you take delight in the praise that we offer you this morning? We ask these things in Christ's name and for his glory. Amen.
Amen. If you'll remain standing this morning, we're going to sing praise. Worship with us this morning.
I'll praise when I'm sure, and praise when I'm down. Now praise when outnumbered and praise when surrounded.
Yeah.
Just praises the waters my enemies drowning. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Now praise when I feel it, and I'll praise when I don't.
No,
I'll praise because I know.
Sing another song of praise this morning, one of my favorites. We will sing of the goodness of God. Worship with us this morning.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. days, I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
His goodness. Would you listen as we sing Evidence?
And all throughout history, your faithfulness has walked beside me.
The winter storms made way for spring. In every season, from where I'm standing,
I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see your promises and fulfillments all over my life, all over my life.
Help me remember when I'm weak. The fear may come, but fear will leave. You lead my heart to victory. You are my strength, and you always will be.
I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see your promises and fulfillment.
Yeah.
the glory and the lifter of our head. He is always there. He sustains us. He never, ever leaves us. He will never, ever forsake us. I know some of you just sat down, but would you stand with us this morning? He's our shield. He's our portion. Whatever you're going through this morning, whatever you're facing, God is good and he is faithful. And he's going to sustain you. He's not going to leave you. He's right there with you, walking with you. And we can praise him this morning. We can thank him for what he's done for us. Would you sing with us this morning? You are my shield, my strength, my portion, deliverer, my shelter, strong tower, my very present help. You are my shield, my strength, my portion, deliverer, my shelter, strong tower, my very present help in time of need. Oh, you're my very present help in time of need. Yes, you're my very present help in time of need.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord, man. Thank you so much for being here with us this morning. And, you know, I've had a lot of time over the last few weeks to consider just the impact of what all God is doing in and through our church family. There's no way to say it any other way than the last few years our church family has experienced such deep grief and sorrow that I don't think that the church can stay the same after walking through all the things that we've walked through. And there is such a sweetness. There's such a sweetness to our gatherings. Amen. I mean, I don't know if you feel that, if you experience that. And it's not just our love for one another, but it's the love of God that dwells within us as believers through the Spirit of God and the power of his presence and his word. And I think what it produces is it produces this longing. I don't know if you, maybe you don't feel this way. I mean, I know I certainly do, but it creates this longing in our souls that we just have a desire to gather on Sunday mornings. And we encourage one another by just our mere presence alone. But we're not here to worship one another. We're here to worship the God of all comfort, who is the Lord Jesus. And I just want to say, once again, just to our church family, thank you so much for the way that you do care for one another, the way that you show up for one another. And I know that when one part of the body hurts, we all hurt. And yet at the same time, when one part of the body rejoices, we should all rejoice together. And so I'm so thankful to be able to gather this morning. I'm so thankful for our praise team and for our choir and for our musicians who work so diligently throughout the week to prepare these songs of worship and praise for us. And I don't take for granted the sacrifice that many of them make so that they can lead us through the throne of grace and that we can sing praises to Jesus. So I want to ask you, if you have your Bible this morning, if you would turn with me into the New Testament gospel, the very first book in the New Testament, the Gospel of Matthew. And as you're turning there, we're going to find ourselves in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 4 this morning. We are concluding a series titled today, Above All. And so beginning the first Sunday of March, we began this study leading up to Easter Sunday, the Resurrection Sunday, and each week looking at a different attribute of Christ that is evident from the resurrected cross that Jesus died and rose again from. And each week we've looked at different themes and different attributes of Christ that God displayed through his son. And then at the end of kind of our Easter time, I just really felt God impressing it upon my heart for us to continue this for a few more weeks, specifically looking at the word of God. And so last week, if you were here, I told you at the beginning of last week's message that the sermon that we preached or the message that was delivered last Sunday was not the message that I had planned to deliver. So if any of you have your sermon note cards from today that were passed out, you will notice that it says April 7th. I just want you to know you are not stuck in a time vortex somewhere. It is not Groundhog Day. It is, in fact, April the 14th, but these cards were already printed before God had kind of moved on my heart to change the message. And so while it may seem like we are preaching last week's sermon, I promise you that we are not. I do believe that God intended for us to preach it today. And so as we look to the Gospel of Matthew chapter 4, we're going to continue looking at the Word of God. Just to kind of give maybe a recap for anybody that wasn't here last week, specifically what we looked at last week is the proof of the resurrection of Christ and what the resurrection means for us today. Specifically, the text that we looked at last week came from the Gospel of Luke chapter 24, where after his bodily resurrection, that the Lord Jesus appeared to two disciples, or two of his followers, not disciples, but two of his followers who were traveling to the city or the town of Emmaus. And while they were on that town, on that road, these two followers of Christ were lamenting the disappointment and their internal sorrow of the death of Christ and the empty tomb. They knew as a fact he died. They knew it was a fact that the tomb was empty, but none of them really believed or had the faith to believe in the bodily resurrection of Jesus. And so as these two guys are literally walking and talking down the road, they're talking about the dead Messiah. The Messiah himself bodily appears to them and asks them why they're so sad. And they begin to tell a risen Jesus that Jesus is dead. And so then as Jesus is probing their heart and their unbelief, it says that he then opens the word of God, he opens the scriptures, and he says that Jesus begins all the way back with the law of Moses. And from the law of Moses to the prophets, he explained to them why the Messiah had to come, why he had to live fully God, fully man, why he had to be betrayed, why he had to be mocked, why he had to be beaten, why he must be crucified, why he must die literally, bodily, actually be dead in the flesh and go into the tomb so that on the third day that he would rise from the dead, and in doing so, he would put to death the curse of sin. And it says as he was explaining these scriptures to these unbelieving followers, it says that they asked him to stop and to come to their home and to dine with them. And as they sat there at this table, the Lord Jesus began to take the bread. And as he lifted up the bread and he blessed it, and as he broke the bread and gave it to them, that was the moment that their eyes were opened and they could see that this person in front of them was not just a messenger of God. This was God in the flesh. And most importantly, this was the risen Savior. And it says that as soon as their eyes were opened and they realized it was Jesus, it says that Jesus vanished from their presence. And these two followers who had been unbelievers and now they're believers, they had facts, they had knowledge, but what they didn't have was faith. And in that moment, their eyes were open. They saw Jesus and they turned to one another and they said, were our hearts not burning within us when he opened the scriptures? These two guys who had walked and talked on the road to Emmaus, they sprinted back to Emmaus where they found the other gathering followers and they told the message of the risen Savior. And that is what we are still resting in today, is the power of Christ and the power of his resurrection. But the text that we're going to look at today comes prior to Jesus's betrayal, prior to his arrest, prior to his scourging, his mocking, his beating, and his crucifixion. This comes at the beginning of Christ's earthly ministry. So if you have your Bibles, we're looking at Matthew chapter 4. We're actually going to begin, I'm going to cheat a little bit, we're going to start in chapter 3, and we're going to look at verse 13. Verse 13 of Matthew chapter 3, it says that Jesus arrived from Galilee at the Jordan. Now it says at the Jordan, this is specifically the Jordan River. And it says, and now coming to John, to be baptized by him. This is John, not to be confused with the disciple John, one of the sons of thunder, but this is John. This was John, known as John the Baptist. This is the one who would be the forerunner of Christ. This would be the one who would be the voice in the wilderness calling out, prepare the way of the Lord. And so Jesus comes to John the baptizer to be baptized. You say, well, why must he be baptized? Baptism, for those of you that are Baptists, which is most of us in this room, baptism is not just putting water on us, our body. Baptism is a picture of death to life. Baptism is not just something that originated in the New Testament. Baptism was a part of the Jewish culture and customs in the Old Testament. So Jesus is now coming to John to be baptized. Why is he being baptized? Even the Lord Jesus, he in his life had to show perfect obedience to God the Father. So by Jesus coming and being baptized, he was showing that even Jesus, even he, God in the flesh, that even he was dying to self so that he could be obedient to God the Father. So he comes to John to be baptized. Look in verse 14. And John tried to stop him. He said to him, Lord, he said, I have the need to be baptized by you, and yet you're coming to me. And Jesus said, allow it at this time, for in this way it is fitting, or it is necessary for us to fulfill all righteousness. And then he was baptized. In verse 16 it says, and after Jesus was baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending as a dove and settling on him. And behold, a voice from the heavens said, this is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased. Now today, we're going to look specifically in the text about the temptation of Christ. And maybe some of you in this room before, maybe you've heard sermons or messages, or you've had Bible studies where you focused on the temptation of the Lord Jesus. Now, maybe you've studied it, you've heard it preached, you've had it taught. What I want to be careful this morning to make sure that we're clear about is as we study this, I am not trying to give you some cheeky examples or some 1, 2, 3, this is how you have victory over temptation and sin. That is not what this message is about. That is not what this text is about. Now, are there principles of overcoming temptation that can be derived from this? Absolutely. But what I hope you see today, that what Jesus was accomplishing through his temptation is so much deeper, it is so much more great than just our ability to be tempted and just to get out of it, okay? So if we can understand that, now let's look to Matthew chapter 4. It says, and Jesus, after being baptized, the heavens open up, the Spirit of God descends like a dove, settling on the Lord Jesus. God the Father's voice rings out for everyone to hear and says, behold, this is my Son in whom I am well pleased. And it says, immediately Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness. Now here's what I want you to know as we consider what Christ is doing and why it happened this way. Let's just recap a few things that we know. Jesus is the Son of God, fully God, fully man. He is the chosen one, the only begotten of the Father. He is the promised Messiah. He is the one by whom all things exist. He was with God in the beginning. All things came into existence by Jesus, through Jesus, and for him. When God created mankind, when he created and he breathed life into the dust of the ground and he formed and fashioned Adam, he created Adam and Eve to dwell with him, to fellowship with him, to walk with him in the Garden of Eden. That's what God's desire was. And when sin entered into the hearts of Adam and Eve, when they were disobedient to God, when they turned their back on God and instead they worshiped themselves instead of the Creator, they then were kicked out of the Garden of Eden. God had a choice. In his sovereign love and wisdom, he could have wiped Adam and Eve out. He could have said, you know what? I'm going to start over. Adam 2.0. But instead, God stayed his wrath and he began to reveal God's divine plan for redemption. The way that we know that that was God's plan is that when he came to a man named Abram, and he woke up Abram in the middle of the night and he said, Abram, get up, take your family and go to the land that I will show you. Abraham's calling was an immediate step of faith. So Abram gets up, he goes to the land and God makes a covenant promise with Abraham. Now this is different than a contract. He makes a covenant. See, a contract has where two sides agree to uphold their end of the bargain. That's not what God did. God made a covenant with Abraham. The entire fulfillment of this covenant was going to be dependent upon who? God. He was the one that made the covenant. He was the one that provided the means for the covenant to be accomplished. And then God was the one that made it so. So he tells Abram, he says, get up, go to a land that I will show you. I'm going to bless you. I am going to make your descendants more numerous than the stars and more than the sands of the seashore. And from this land, from your family, there will come a blessing for the entire world. This is the first messianic prophecy that we see there following the one in the garden when the Lord God said to the serpent, while you may bruise the heel of my servant, he is going to crush your head. So here's what I want you to know. Christ's victory over Satan began way before he went to the cross. It was accomplished. The death blow that we're still waiting for, death is the final enemy to be defeated. It's already won. It's already been promised. Because it's not based on our efforts or our merits, but on God's. You say, well, what does that have to do with the temptation of Christ? Well, I'm thankful that you asked. Matthew chapter 4 says that Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. Now, why is this significant? Why is this important to us? Well, there's a couple things we need to consider. Number one, when God chose, when he declared his covenant promises through Abraham, God's people, Israel, they were in captivity some years later in Egypt. God rose up another savior, a forerunner of Christ, a type of Christ, if you will, named Moses. And through Moses, God provided a man empowered by God to save God's people from captivity. And as Pharaoh's heart had been hardened and hardened and hardened, and then through God's power and his might, Pharaoh relented and let God's people go. The first thing that we see happen as Moses is leading the nation of Israel from the exit of Egypt is they must cross over the sea. And as Moses' staff touches the waters part. The nation of Israel crosses through the waters on dry ground. And when they make it to the other side, God causes the waters to close up behind them, killing Pharaoh and all of his army. Now, here's what happens. Just to recap really quick, God made a promise to Abraham that he would provide redemption and deliverance and good news and a blessing for the whole world. Some years later, God's messianic redemption timeline is continuing on. Now it's working. God is working through Moses. God uses Moses to deliver his people from captivity. Now they cross through the sea, and now they're in the wilderness. And for the next 40 years, Israel would be tested in the wilderness. Now, when you look, you don't have to turn there, but we're going to get there later in the sermon. But when you get to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, what you'll see there is that the language that Paul uses to describe this Exodus, the language that Paul uses to describe Israel crossing through the sea, he says that all of Israel was baptized into Moses. And after they were baptized into Moses, it says, then they went into the wilderness of sin. And that's where they would be tempted. Now, here's what I want you to see. Everything that God promised through Abraham, he has now completed in Jesus. Every area that Israel failed in their temptation in the wilderness, Christ accomplished perfectly. So we're going to kind of ping pong back and forth here. Here we go. Matthew chapter 4, verse 1. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And after he had fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, he then became hungry. Now, not only in every area that Israel failed did Jesus accomplish, but also Moses as a type of Christ, even Moses who failed, Jesus is the better Moses. He's the better Adam. He's the better Moses. When Moses went up onto the mountain to be alone with the Lord for 40 days and 40 nights, there where God gave him the commandments of promise, then when Moses came down from the mountain, it says his face shone the radiance of the glory of God. When Jesus was going out into the wilderness, he's been baptized by John. He's now beginning the inauguration of his earthly ministry, and it is necessary for Jesus to be tempted. Because why is it necessary for Jesus to be tempted? In order to show that he's fully God and fully man. And that he was able to accomplish this yet without sin. So as Jesus now is heading into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil, Again, I told you this is not meant to be an outline of how to overcome just temptation. Now, it can be interpreted as that by some principles, but that's not just the purposes of what God is doing. It says, after 40 days and 40 nights, the Lord Jesus became hungry. And look here in verse 3. And now the tempter arrives, the enemy, Satan, the devil. He arrives in verse 3. And he says to Jesus, if you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread. Now, I just want you to know, all these years later, the way that the enemy attacks you and I are not original. All he has to do is take God's words and barely twist them. In the book of Genesis chapter 3, we read that God told Adam and Eve that they had dominion over the entire garden. He told Adam and Eve that they could eat of any tree in the entire garden, yet except for the tree of knowledge of good and evil. When the serpent came to Eve, do you remember the words the serpent said to Eve? He said, did God really say that you can't eat of any of the trees? It's a subtle twisting of God's words. God didn't say you can't eat of any of the trees. He said you can eat of all except the one. And then the serpent doubles down on that and he says to Eve, God knows if you eat from this tree that you will become like him, knowing good from evil. The same way that Satan would take God's words and twist them and manipulate them to manipulate our hearts is his same tactic that he takes to Jesus. Look here in verse 3. Jesus has been baptized. The Spirit of God descends upon him like a dove. The voice of God the Father says, this is my Son in whom I am well pleased. And the first of a series of questions that Satan asks Jesus is, if you are the Son of God. He is taking what God just said, and he's barely twisting them just a little. And he makes this statement, if you are the Son of God, I've seen you, Jesus, out here for 40 days and 40 nights. You must be hungry. So if you are the Son of God, then command these stones to become bread. Jesus answers the tempter and he says, it is written. Now, just before we go any further, Jesus answers with what? The scripture. He answers with the word of God. He says, it is written that man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes out of the mouth of God. Now, what is he quoting? He is quoting Deuteronomy chapter 8. Why is he quoting Deuteronomy chapter 8? Deuteronomy chapter 8, verses 2 through 4 says this, the Lord God says through Moses, and you shall remember the whole way that the Lord your God led you for these 40 years in the wilderness, that he might humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart and whether you would keep his commandments or not. And he humbled you and he let you know hunger. And he fed you with manna. Now, this is what God is saying through Moses to his people. God fed you with manna, which you did not know. Now, for those of us who are familiar with the Exodus account, we know that God provided manna every day for his people to eat. They had no clue what manna was. Manna didn't exist. God created manna just for the purpose of providing for his people. So Jesus is quoting this. He says, it is written that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God. When Jesus says every word that comes out of the mouth of God, I want you to understand this, what he's saying. Every word is every promise of God, every covenant of God, the character and the nature and the divine attributes of God. That is what we will live on. When God rescued and led his people from captivity, he did not send them into the wilderness to die, even though that's what many of them thought. He provided manna for them when they had no idea what manna was. He says, nor did your fathers know that he might make you know that man does not live alone, but man lives by every word that comes out of the mouth of the Lord. In verse 4 of Deuteronomy chapter 8, he says, and your clothing did not wear out on you, and your foot did not swell in those 40 years. You thought, man, these people are out in the middle of the wilderness for 40 years. Where'd they shop? Where'd they get their clothes? The Lord even sustained their clothes. Was that Maya? I don't even know where she is. But anyway, the Lord sustained their clothes just so that he would know that he was providing. So let's come back to what Jesus is saying to Satan. Satan says, if you are the Son of God, then command these stones and make yourself bread. And this is what Jesus' reply is. And if you have your note card, you're going to fill it in there. Jesus says, I will live by God's word. So what's the temptation for you and I? The temptation for us is that if we feel like we have a need, if we're tempted by something, and temptation is not always just a temptation to do something, there's also a temptation to not believe and to trust God's word and to not wait on God's timing. There is a temptation when you don't see any way, when you just don't see how God can do anything, when you just don't see how God can take what was meant for evil and turn it to good. And there's a temptation that is there. Jesus says to Satan, to the tempter, he said, I will not just live by bread alone. This is what he's saying. I am not going to manipulate my Father's plans for my life in order to give myself something now that I know my God will provide for me. This is what I'm saying to you, church. There is a temptation in your life and in my life to take our lives and to believe that our life is our own to make. And that if we need something, that we can give it to us. We can provide it for ourselves. And what God said to Moses and to Israel, you needed to eat. You were going to be hungry. You had no clue where the food was going to come from. And I provided manna for you when you didn't even know what manna was. And this is what Jesus is saying to the tempter. You think I'm hungry? What you think, Satan, that I need is food? What I'm here to tell you is anything I need, God already knows that I need it before I know I need it. And I'm going to live by his promises and know that he's faithful and true. Somebody say amen if you're with me this morning. Come on now. Now look, I love C.S. Lewis. Some of y'all know that and some of you don't. And that's okay. You can be wrong. But C.S. Lewis says it like this. He says, God cannot give us happiness and peace apart from himself. Because it is not there. No such thing exists. Satan said, what you really need right now is food. Jesus said, no, what I really need right now is God. So I'm going to live by God's word. Let's continue reading. Verse 5. So then Satan says, okay. The devil then takes him up to the holy city. He takes him up to Jerusalem. And he brings him up to the pinnacle of the temple. And now he says to Christ again. He said, if you are then the Son of God, then throw yourself down from this place. For it is written that God will give his angels orders concerning you, and on their hands they will lift you up so that you do not strike your foot against a stone. Now, there's two things that Satan did here. Once again, he brings into question, is Jesus really the Son of God? The second thing that Satan does is he quotes scripture. Now, listen, friend, if you think you don't need to know the word of God for yourself, can I tell you like a little secret? Satan knows the word of God better than all of you. Do you hear me? He knows the word of God. And if you don't know the word of God for yourself, you are lying and deceiving yourself if you think he can't take God's words and twist it and manipulate it if you don't know the difference. That's why Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. My sheep will not listen to a wrong shepherd. They will listen to my voice. So what I'm pleading with you this morning is if you want to be able to know God's voice, you got to know his word. So Satan says this. He says, why don't you throw yourself down and call on God's angels or your angel armies to save you. And this is what he's saying. If you really are the Son of God, you should be able to have the power of God to provide for yourself. You don't need God, you're his son. The second thing he says, if you're the Son of God, then you should also have command over his angel armies. Why don't you do this and you provoke God to have to act on your behalf? And then he quotes scripture from Psalm 91 and he says, God will send his angels concerning you. That's not what Psalm 91 says. What Psalm 91 says is that God will send his angels concerning all of his ways and all of his plans. You say, well, what's the issue here? Jesus responds back to Satan. He says, on the other hand, it is written, scripture. Jesus says, you shall not put the Lord your God to test. This is what many people do today. We ignore God's words. We ignore God's promises. We lament God's timing. And sometimes what seems his silence, and then we are tempted to say, okay, God, if you're real, I need you to prove yourself to me. And then we put ourselves in these positions where we are then trying to manipulate God as if he has to do something else to prove himself to us. Now, when Jesus is quoting this scripture, he's quoting Deuteronomy chapter 6, where the Lord says through Moses that you shall not put the Lord your God to test as you tested him at Meribah. Well, what happened at Meribah? Well, I'm glad you asked. You guys are just really good students this morning. Well, in Exodus chapter 17, Israel is in the wilderness, and guess what they're doing? They're complaining again. They're grumbling again. They're tired of manna. They're tired of these blessings. And now they come to Moses and they say, we are thirsty. And apparently, Moses, you don't care if we die. You know what, Moses? It would have been better if we had just stayed slaves in Egypt. Does God not care about us? So Moses literally goes to God and says to him, these people, your people, if you don't do something, they're going to kill me. So God says, okay. He says, Moses, take your staff, the same staff that you used to part the waters that I parted for you so that you would cross over into the wilderness. God says, Moses, take that same staff and go to this rock and strike the rock, and I will provide water from the rock. And they put the Lord God to test. Now, Moses struck the rock. He did what God was supposed to do. Now, if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn me to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. I'm going to need y'all to do two things at once. I'm going to need you to turn and listen at the same time. And that's tough for some of us to do. I can't like pat and rub at the same time. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. So the first time that, well, not the first, but the first time that God tells Moses to go and strike the rock, he does it. And God opens up the water from the rock to provide the needs for his people after the people tested him. Sometime later, you'll find in Numbers chapter 20, you don't have to turn there, but in Numbers chapter 20, once again, the people are thirsty again. And they're grumbling again. They're going to die again. That's what they're saying. We're going to die of thirst. This time, the Lord tells Moses something different. He says, when you go to that rock, this time don't strike the rock. This time, the Lord says through Moses, he says, speak to the rock. And he says, and when you speak to the rock, water will come. But do you know what happened when they got to the rock that time? It says that this time that Moses hit the rock twice. There was a major problem with this. God had already provided the rock of salvation. He had already provided living water, and it had already been struck one time. And that one time that Moses struck it, that was sufficient. So now the second time, when God sends Moses back to the same rock, he says, you don't have to strike it anymore. All you have to do is talk to it, and it'll give you what you need. And the second time, he hit it twice. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, this is what Paul says. Brothers, I don't want you to be unaware that for our fathers who were led out by the cloud and they passed under and through the sea, in verse 2 of 1 Corinthians 10, and they were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and they all ate the same spiritual food, and they all drank the same spiritual drink, for they were drinking from a spiritual rock which followed them. And would you look there, and what does it say? And the rock was Christ. Here's what I want you to understand, people. Christ has died one time for all time. Jesus never has to go back to the cross again. His grace is sufficient. His mercy is enough. His love and his blood is enough, and it never runs dry. And so the same way that when Jesus was going to provoke God to save him from the angels, if he listened to the temptation of the enemy, Jesus said, you shall not put the Lord your God to test. Here's what I'm here to tell you, people. God's love and his mercy has already been poured out on the cross for you, and his resurrection proves that it was sufficient. He is already the rock. The rock that we dwell on, the rock that our faith is built on, is the Lord Jesus. He has already been struck one time. And if you come back to God and you say, God, I need you to do this for me. If you're really real, then show yourself to me. God, I hear your promises, but I just don't believe them. I need you to do that. You know what you're doing? You're whipping Christ again. You're striking the rock. He has already been beaten for us. You don't have to hit him again. Instead, you come to him and say, oh God, you know my needs. You know my heart. You know my wanderings. You know everything I need. So instead of me provoking you and putting you to test, instead, I'm going to speak to you. I'm going to share my heart with you. I'm going to cry out to you in my private places. And when I get in my inner room and I cry out to God, I know you hear my voice. And you incline your ear to me. And so because of that, I know that you know what I need. And I'm going to live in that. So the second thing that we learn from Jesus is Jesus says to Satan, he says, I will live by God's word. The second thing that Jesus says, I will put my trust in God. This is not something that you and I just say like one time. This is something that we have to say every day. Because you know what? A day has enough worries of its own, don't it? How many of you guys ever have a hard time sleeping because you're worried about the next day? You know, this day's got enough troubles. But you know what? God will give me sufficient grace for this day. So when I wake up today on Sunday, I say, God, I'm going to trust you for Sunday. I'm not going to worry about Monday. I'm going to trust you for this day. And then tomorrow when I wake up, I'm going to bring fresh trust to you because I know that, God, you're going to pour that out from your rock because you've already been beaten. You've already been scourged for me. Your promises are true. But that's not enough for Satan, so he decides to tempt Jesus a third time. And it says in verse 8, it says, again, then the devil took him along to a very high mountain, and he showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And Satan said to him, look at this world. It says he took him out so that Jesus could see all of the earthly kingdoms. And Satan says to Jesus, he says, look at this. Look at this. Look at these kingdoms. Look at all this stuff. Isn't this great? And then he says to Jesus, he says, all of these things I can give to you. You can have it now. You don't have to wait for it. Hey, I've been listening. I've been listening the last few years, Jesus. You don't have to die. You want to be beaten for these people? You want to be beaten for these people? You want to take their sin? You don't have to do that. You don't have to do that. I can give this to you right now. This all can be yours. You can have it. You can be the king of this world. I'll give it to you. All you have to do is fall down and worship me. That's all you have to do. Then Jesus said to him, go away, Satan. He had had enough. He had entertained his voices and his words and the twisting of God's words enough. And Jesus says, for it is written that you shall worship the Lord your God and serve him and him alone. And it says in verse 11, and then the devil left him, and behold, the angels came and began to minister to him. What did Christ say to Satan? He said it there. He said, I will worship God alone. Will you look at these statements that Jesus said? He said, I will live by God's word. I will put my trust in God, and I will serve him alone. You say, well, Pastor, this sounds like an outline for how to overcome temptation. There is no outline, there are no principles, there are no how-tos to overcome temptation that will ever be acceptable or possible apart from the power and the presence of Christ manifest in your life through his word. I want to give you a few lies to think about today. You say, well, why is this important for us to think about? Why is it important for us to consider these things today? Where Israel failed, Christ did not. Where Moses failed, Christ did not. When Moses struck that rock the second time, God's condemnation was poured out upon Moses. And Moses was not granted access into the promised land because he failed when he was under trial. You say, well, you know what? That sounds harsh. You know what? That sounds like God is unjust. The problem is we live in a world where we're constantly obsessed with loving ourselves and desiring the praise of other people's lips. But the truth is, if we'll be honest with ourselves before God, we know that all of us have fallen short of his glory, that all of us are sinners. Now see, all of you that I see in this room, there was a time when all of you were kids, all right? I know that's been a long time for some of you, but you were at one point. You may not remember. I have never had to teach my son or daughter how to be disobedient to me. I have never had to sit down with Bo and go, hey, if you want to know what really gets on my nerves, come here, let me give you some things. Now, I may have been tempted to go, hey, if you really want to get under your mom's skin, let me just give you a couple things to... Now, I may plant those seeds, but the underlying issues were already there. Children, they have a way of displaying the sinful nature that's there. Adults, we're just better at hiding it and lying to ourselves about it. You say, well, why is this there? Because, guys, men and women of the church, of the body, you and I are going to face temptation every day of our life, period. And while we're here, we experience temptation in many different ways. A lot of people think temptation is only like a temptation to do some like specific sin. But I'm gonna tell you the biggest temptation that we see here from Christ, that Satan was trying to manipulate Christ's heart, was the temptation to not believe God. It was the temptation to not trust God. And it was the temptation to not serve him. Because at the end of the day, whatever sin that we fall into, whatever temptation that overtakes us, that's really what it's about. It's about loving ourselves more than we love God. It's about desiring to please ourselves more than it is to please God. It's about putting our trust in our own abilities rather than trusting God. And truthfully, the biggest issue of temptation, it's about serving our own desires versus serving God. So let me give you some common lies about temptation. Here's a lie that people think. Whenever you're being tempted, whatever it may be, sin, unbelief, in present trials and sufferings, you'll say this. This is a temptation or a lie that comes from the enemy. And it sounds like this. You know what? No one has ever faced what you're facing. It's a lie. Satan will say, no one's really ever faced what you're facing. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, Paul says this. There is no temptation that has overtaken any of us except what is common to mankind. But God is faithful, so he will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation, God will provide a way of escape so that you will be able to endure it. Temptation is going to happen, and the temptation that you and I face, it's common to each of us. Where's the power? Where's the secret to endure temptation? You want to know what it is? It's the faithfulness of God. And it's the provision of God through his word and through his power. Here's another lie that we get from the enemy, and we say to ourselves, well, you know what? I am tempted to this sin, but maybe God wants me to do this. Maybe God wants me to do this. Maybe God wants me to do something unnatural. Maybe God wants me to love myself more than my spouse or my kids. Maybe God wants me to desire someone of the same sex instead of the opposite gender. And if that desire is there, then this must be from God. Because if I feel it in my body, in my soul, in my spirit, this must be from God. So the second lie is that God would actually tempt us to sin. James chapter 1, verses 12 through 4 says, blessed is the man who perseveres under trial, for once he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. For no one is to say that when he is tempted, that I am being tempted by God, for God cannot be tempted by evil, and he does not tempt anyone with evil. But each one is tempted when they are carried away and enticed by their own lust. Here's the other side of the lie. Here's the truth under that lie. Any temptation that you and I experience, it was already there underneath, and it was in our sin nature. And that is the very reason that Christ came to die, is because he's the one that gives us the victory through his resurrected life. What's another lie? Here's another lie. Well, God doesn't understand my temptation. He doesn't understand what it's like to face temptation. God doesn't know what I'm feeling. God doesn't care about my temptation. Hebrews chapter 2, verses 17 through 18. Therefore, he, being Jesus, had to be made like his brothers in every respect, so that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God, so that he could make propitiation for the sins of his people. For because he himself has suffered when he was tempted, he is then able to save, to help those when they are tempted. You say, well, God doesn't understand. He does. And because he understands, that's why when you cry out to Jesus, who is our high priest, he is not cold and calloused in heaven. He understands because he has faced what you're facing. So that means that he is merciful towards you and he is kind towards you. He is slow to anger and what? Quick to forgiveness. Thank God for his long suffering in our life. And here's the fourth lie that we deal with. That when you are tempted, and when you fall, that you cannot bring it to God. That's exactly where God wants you to be. That's exactly where the enemy wants you to be. The enemy wants you to believe that when you fall into temptation and that you succumb into it, that you cannot bring it to God. But Hebrews chapter 4 tells us this. Therefore, since we have such a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to our confession, a faith in him. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize in our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in all things, just as we are, yet without sin. And listen to verse 16 of Hebrews 4. Therefore, let us approach the throne of grace with what? With apprehension? Let us approach the throne of grace with timidity. Let us approach the throne of grace with nervousness, with anxiousness. No, let us approach the throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us at our time of need. When Jesus was facing temptation, he brought that temptation to God. If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread. This is what Satan said to Jesus. If you're really God, give yourself what you want. Jesus brought that to God. He says, it is written that man shall not live by bread alone, by every word that comes out of the mouth of God. He says, I am going to bring it to God. I'm going to trust him. I'm going to live by his word. Satan comes in. If you are the Son of God, then throw yourself down and prove yourself to be the Son of God. Make God show himself to be for you and not against you. He said, I will not put the Lord God to test. You know what, Jesus? If you really want to be the king, if you really want to be the Lord of all lords, I can give you what you want right now. You don't have to wait. You don't have to suffer. You can have it. Jesus says, I will serve him alone. You and I face temptation every single day to not trust God, to not believe him, to not wait on God. How are you doing in that? What does that look like every day in your life? I mean, are any of these temptations present in your life? Are you encountering this? I mean, when's the last time that you were tempted to not trust God? When's the last time that you were tempted to believe the wisdom of the world versus the wisdom of his word? When is the last time that you were tempted to give yourself something instead of waiting on God? When is the last time that you were tempted with serving your own desires instead of serving him? Philippians chapter 2, we read this during the Easter time, but think about what these words mean in light of this. Jesus, who existed in the form of God, yet he did not regard equality with God something that could be grasped, but he emptied himself, taking on the form of a bondservant, humbling himself, becoming obedient to God, obedient to the point of death, and death on a cross. And from this, God has highly bestowed upon him what? The name that is above all names. Friends, James says that when you and I face temptation, that God is faithful. Listen to these promises. This is what, when Jesus said, I will live by God's word, this is what I want you to know. When you're tempted to sin, whether it be tempted to sin on your phone, whether it's tempted to sin by your eyes, whether it's tempted to sin by your words, whether it's a temptation to sin by your actions, whatever the temptation is, the lie of the enemy says no one's ever experienced this, no one knows what it's like, that God probably is the one that wants you to do this, that God doesn't care. Another lie of the enemy says, well, you've messed up now. Well, clearly you've messed up, and God wants no part of you. No, that's not the word of God. The word of God says that we can boldly become the throne of grace. Why? Because we have a high priest who understands, because he's merciful. And he provides us help in our time of need. But above all of these things, above all of these things is the word of God. The power of his word. My friend, I wanted to share this with you. Martin Luther, one of the reformers, said this a long time ago. He said, the Bible is alive. He said, it speaks to me. The Bible has feet. It even runs after me. It even has hands, and it lays its hands on me. For the Bible is not antique, nor is it modern. The Bible is eternal. Charles Spurgeon said, I'm afraid that there are some professing Christians that cannot say that they even have shifted their bookmark in the Bible every day. Probably of all the books, this is still Spurgeon. Spurgeon says, probably of all the books that have ever been printed, the most widely circulated and the least read book in the world is the Bible. Guys, we have literally the power of God, the Word of God, incarnate, living, breathing right here. All the promises are true. And you are going to face temptation and trials and sufferings, and God has not left you to do it alone. His Son did perfectly for you and I what we could not do. And He has left us every promise of God completely fulfilled. You say, well, Pastor, what are you trying to say? I'm trying to tell you, I'm trying to confess to you this morning that there is no power that I have over temptation that I can have apart from Christ. And the first temptation you have to overcome is the temptation of unbelief. And so if you're here today and you don't believe in Jesus as your Lord and Savior and you don't belong to Him, I want to ask you this morning, has God been at work in your soul today or this week? Has the Spirit of God been drawing you to Jesus? Do you see your need for God? Do you see your sin and the weight of your sin and how crushing that it is? Do you feel the weight in your chest right now? Have you tried to remove that weight by human means? And do you understand that you don't have to? You don't have to do that on your own. God did it for you through His Son, Jesus. And that's the good news of the gospel, that we are not saved by our works. We're not saved by anything we can do. We are saved by grace through faith in the Lord Jesus. And then after He saves us, He sustains us. And He walks with us and He talks with me everywhere we go. And His word, His promises are true. And most importantly, God is faithful. That's the God we know. I'm so thankful of all the promises of God. I'm so thankful that He hears our voice. I'm so thankful that God understands our sufferings. And I'm so thankful God had victory over it. So I just want to ask you this morning, if you don't know Christ today, are you ready to put your trust in Him? What are you waiting for? You're trying to figure this whole thing out? You're trying to theologically and mentally and understand it intellectually? We're saved by faith. And there are many in this room in the last few weeks that they have come to genuine faith in Christ because of the sufferings in their life. The first temptation we have to overcome is the temptation to not believe God. And then once God has given you the victory over that in salvation, then every day we can come before the throne of grace and He meets us there. Father, thank You for Your word. Thank You for Your promises. Thank You, God, that in Your Son, Jesus, that every promise You made is yes and amen. Thank You, God, that the temptation that we face every single day, that God, we know that You have overcome. Father, I pray this morning for anyone in this room under the sound of my voice that does not know Jesus as their Savior. I pray that right now in this moment, they would look to Him and by faith, they would confess with their mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in their heart that God has raised Him from the dead and they will be saved. And if there's anyone here this morning that you profess Christ, you put your faith in Christ today, even now in this moment, do not leave this place without sharing that with a pastor or one of our leaders at our Next Step table. We want to pray with you and celebrate what God has done in your life. But no doubt there are many of us today that temptation has overtaken us because we've tried to defeat it by our own means, and that is impossible apart from Jesus. Father, I pray that it would be Your Son, Jesus, that we would realize that He is the one that gives us the victory over temptation. Father, that we would live by Your word, that we would put our trust in You, and that, God, we would serve You and You alone. Father, we pray that You would be glorified in this place as we respond now to this message. In Christ's name, amen. I'm going to invite you to stand with me this morning. We're going to have a time of invitation and response. I know that God has been moving in people's hearts and lives today, and whatever it is that God is doing, I want you to be faithful to that. Whether it's for salvation, repentance, unbelief, maybe you want to grab that hand of your loved one. Our pastors and our pastors' wives are about to spread out in the room during this time. Don't leave if you can't. If you don't have to leave, please don't. Service is not over yet. This is the most important time. You've heard me preach. The Holy Spirit of God's been moving in your pew and your seat, and now it's your time to be responsible for what God has been doing in your heart. You don't have to tell me, but what God's been doing in you, you all have to be faithful in responding to Him. So as they sing this morning, as they lead us, would you respond to God this morning?
it runs deep. Your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are.
In where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you.
So teach my soul to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you.
'Cause Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
You guys can have a seat really quick. Pastor Dustin and Pastor Matt have a few announcements they're going to give us this morning. At this time, we're going to receive our tithes and offerings. We'd kind of do that now at the end of our service. We used to do it at the front of our service for a long, long time, but we started doing it at the end of our service so that way we could just have a little bit more of a kind of worshipful time at the beginning of our service instead of going song, offering, song, announcement, song, shake somebody in the pew next to you. And so not in that order. And so I just want to say as they're receiving our offerings, thank you so much just for your faithfulness and giving. We are so thankful for God's provision in our church. I do want to give you an update on a few things financially. We're going to be having a business meeting this Wednesday night at church. We're going to be giving out kind of the finance report for 2023, and we'll have that available in handouts that they'll be available throughout the church. Even if you can't be here this Wednesday night, you can still get a copy of it. Wanted to have you an update on where we are with our new life group building. So we're working through the permit process. Hopefully we're going to have the permit hopefully sometime in the next few weeks. And hopefully you're going to see some ground being moved sometime before this fall. And so we're really excited. We'll give you an update about all that. It's not going to catch us by surprise, okay? You'll know it's coming. But I wanted to do something a little bit different today. So before these guys come and do a few announcements, we started doing something a little bit differently a few months ago, where the first Sunday of every month, we have our GH 101 class, which is a class for people that are visiting Glen Haven, that are interested in learning more about our church. And then at the end of every month, we present new members to the church. But we have one couple that's come forward today that has been here, a part of our church family for a long time, but wants to actually become an official member. And I felt like this was just the right day to do it. And as the lead pastor, I'm just calling pastoral privileges today, okay? I don't pull that very often, so I wanted to do that today. So I wanted to just come and stand alongside Tyler and Michelle Rachels and ask Pastor Jared if you guys would stand with me. This is Tyler and Michelle and their son, Brighton. Hey, buddy, you want to stand with Mom and Dad right here? Or you want to sit right with Miss Jenna? You sit right there, okay? So we got Tom. We're going to stand here together. Jared, why don't you come up here, buddy? So this is Tyler and Michelle, and this is Mr. Zeke. And he is sitting with Cece. And then we got Mr. Brighton. And so I just want to say thank you for your love and your prayer for this precious family. And those prayers are not stopping, and we're not going anywhere, right, church? And so we want to, amen. And many of you may not have heard yesterday Michelle's testimony that she shared at Zade's Celebration of Life service, but I'm going to tell you, she shared the gospel in a way that was more powerful than I don't know if I ever can. And so we really are believing that there are going to be many around the throne of grace because of Zade's life. And so what I wanted to do is I just wanted to pray over Tyler and Michelle and all of their family. And so church, I'm going a little bit out of order here. So I wanted to ask you to do something with me. Would you all stand together with me? I just wanted us to pray if we can towards this family. So if you feel comfortable, you know, kind of grabbing the hand of that neighbor, you do that. And we're just going to lift this family up. We are so thankful for this family and what God has done in their life. And we just want to give praise for them and for Zade this morning. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we come before you in the name of Jesus, God, thanking you that God, that you feel our sorrow, that God, you feel our grief, that you feel our pain. And God, yet you also fill us with hope and joy. Father, we have seen your power displayed through Tyler and Michelle in these past few weeks. God, we are so thankful for their family, for their marriage, for their home, and for their three precious sons. And Father, I'm thankful to know that their son, who is now with you in this moment, that when we close our eyes and we pray to you, that God, that we know that Zade is there in heaven. And Lord, he is with so many of our precious little ones who've gone home. Father, we know that Zade is there with Lila. Lord, he is there with Brinley. He is there with Andrew and so many others. And so, Father, I just pray that today that your church body, that you would come alongside this family, and that, Father, that your love would be displayed through them. Father, we believe that there are going to be many, many that come to know Christ and spend eternity with Zade because of his life. So I pray for Brighton and for Zeke. I pray for these precious boys that, Father, they would know your love and your strength and your grace, and that most of all, God, you would be glorified in and through their lives. Father, we give you praise by faith in all these things in Christ's name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. All right. Wow. Isn't God good? Just take a few moments. Yeah. Let's. God is so good. So we just have a few announcements we're going to share with you before dismissing. It's that time of the church year where things just start happening a lot as we are heading for the summer. And one of our big events we are looking forward to is our children's camp coming up later this year. If you currently have a child signed up to go to kids camp right after the service, please make your way up to Children's Church. Pastor Kevin is going to have a meeting there. If you are not able to be there for this one, please be there this Wednesday after Wednesday night, also up in Children's Church. Now, on the theme of children, we have a small event coming up in a few months called VBS. Vacation Bible School, as you know, around here is a big deal. So if you plan to have your child be a part of that, if you plan to volunteer, please go ahead and RSVP to that and sign up. You can go to vbs.life. And if you have any questions at all about that, please call the church. We'll be happy to answer your questions. And then next Sunday, we have an event that we love doing that we're very excited about, our James 1:27 banquet. If you are a church member that is a widow or a widower, this is an opportunity for you to come, for us to just bless you as you have been a blessing to us, as it says in Scripture. So if you would like to come to that, please call the church office this week. Let them know, and we'll get you down on the list. Pastor Dustin?
Okay, and then just a couple more things. We have our Haven event coming up for our ladies. That's going to be on April the 28th, that Sunday afternoon. And if you've been to those before, you know everyone is special and God moves in unique ways. And so we want you to mark your calendar, make sure you are here for that night. You will not regret it. But I have one couple I want to recognize, Mr. Dan and Ms. Cheryl Camp, if they're here, if they'd stand for me, where are they seated at this morning? Right up there. This is going to be their last Sunday here with us, and they have been faithful members for so long. And so we want to make sure we express our love for them, but also our prayers for them as they're taking this next step in life. So if you would, give it up for them. Churches are built on members like them. Last thing I want to leave you with, just, and I won't take long. A lot of you have been asking about the trip we just got back from Honduras, things that God was doing there, and God is at work in the nations. And that is very evident here at home and all throughout the world. And my prayer for that week for our students who went, we took 15 high school students, is that God would expand their view of him and that they would stand in awe of who he is and what he is doing. And to see that God is at work more than just here in Henry County, just here in McDonough, but God has a broad view for all people of all tongues, of all nations. And God honored that prayer. And just one story I want to share with you. The first day that we were there, we got to go to a very poor village, hand out food bags, and we had a couple people ask for prayer, ask us to come to their home to pray. And there was this one young lady who was holding a baby, and she just came to us and she said, "Would you come and pray for my home?" And so we walked, and she had under construction what the best description I can give you is probably 10 by 10 or 12 by 12. It had just thin tree trunks as a corner post, and it had a half of a tin roof. And she was about to wrap it in plastic and move in and sleep on the dirt floor with her four-month-old baby. And she's just so excited and asking for God's blessing on it. And so I go back and I speak to Audel, who him and Stephanie head up Good Samaritan Baptist Mission down there in Honduras. And the Holy Spirit just put on my heart just to ask, do you think her and the guy she's talking about, that they're married? And he says, no. He said, in these villages, most people, they're not married. And he said, I really doubt that they are. And I just asked him, I said, if we were to come together and to ask them if they'd be willing to get married, that we would construct a home for them, do you think that would be okay? And he said, absolutely, you want to go right now? And I said, okay, well, let's go. And so we go, we talk to this young lady, and she's ecstatic, and she's like, I would do it. But she didn't know about the guy who was in the picture. He's at work, works 7 days a week. He leaves his house at 4 a.m. every morning. She's like, I don't know what he'll say. And so we get a call the next day. Otto is in a truck behind us, and he leans out the window as we're sitting on a flatbed truck, and he yells out, he said yes. And we're losing our minds on the back of this truck, and it's like roles reversed. She proposed to him, so he said yes. And so Stephanie turns to me and she said, well, I think we can make this wedding happen on Saturday. And I'm thinking to myself, that was never what I was thinking was gonna happen. I was thinking, you know, a few months from now they might get married, no. And just throughout the week, me and Stephanie and Otto got to sit down with this couple and do marriage counseling with them. And to just explain to them, because culturally to them, a marriage is not emphasized. There's not much intimacy between a man and a woman once a child comes to the picture. Culturally, women treat child as the main priority, and the husband sees his only role as providing, and there's nothing else. And we got to show them through Scripture the goodness of God, his intent for marriage. And we looked at them and we said, do you agree to this? To which the young man Yelvin said to me, it's in God's word, it's what it says, what else could be? So yes, I do. And so we were able to do that wedding on Saturday. I got to officiate a Honduran wedding, which was amazing. Our students through the week got to do so many incredible things, sharing their testimony, encouraging people, and then they got to take part in that. Getting her ready on the wedding day, got to be the bridal party in the wedding in Honduras, and it was just such a special time. But here's the takeaway for me, the last thing that I will say. What better picture of the transformation power of God than to see that take place for this young couple who their hope and dream, this is what they told us, was for their house not to be wrapped in plastic, but to just have adobe bricks. But for God to step in and do something miraculous, to bring them into a marriage now where they understand the goodness of God and what he intends, the picture of Christ and his church in marriage, and how they can reflect that and be a challenge to other people in their village. And now for their daughter to get to grow up in a loving home with a unified family, bonded in marriage, with a home that was more than they could ever imagine, that different people were donating to make happen. God is good. And so our students got to see that. And so I just wanted to share that story with you guys, and just pray that you continue to pray for missions as you give to our offering.